Beyond Alpha Centauri, Exploit Nearby Stars for Colonization, by Isaac Arthur, NSS President. In the 10 years I've been producing Science and Futurism with Isaac Arthur, one of the most popular topics has consistently been space colonization. Of the 700 episodes we've done, Colonizing Alpha Centauri remains the most watched, leading the second place episode by about a million views. Much like Mars, Alpha Centauri holds a special place in our collective imagination as the default target for exploration, the first place we might settle beyond our home, the first planet outside our own system, the first other star humanity may reach. Both destinations have strong arguments in their favor, but in recent years, there's been a renewed discussion about whether Mars is truly the best choice. Even if it is, we must also consider what comes next, which planets, moons, or asteroids we might explore and settle after Mars. Alpha Centauri has long been the poster child for interstellar colonization. As the nearest stellar system to Earth, it has captivated scientists and space enthusiasts alike. But perhaps we should broaden our perspective, considering alternative destinations or future steps beyond our first interstellar outpost. Predicting the speeds of future spacecraft is difficult, but I often use 5% and 10% of speed of light as reasonable estimates, fast enough to be plausible, yet slow enough to keep the math simple. At these speeds, a journey to a system 10 light years away would take 100 to 200 years, significantly limiting our range. This distance excludes many promising G-type stars with potentially habitable planets. In fact, aside from Alpha Centauri and our own Sun, there are no G-type yellow dwarfs or K-type orange dwarfs within 10 light years. However, that still leaves us some intriguing options. There are quite a few stars, and likely even more substellar objects, within 10 light years. And if we ever get fusion working, brown dwarfs and even rogue planets drifting through interstellar space could become viable prospects for settlement. With functioning fusion power, not only does 10% light speed travel become far more plausible, we could even colonize Kuiper Belt or Oort Cloud objects. We might even find some interesting brown dwarfs or gas giant options closer than Alpha Centauri. Our next candidate is Barnard's Star, located just 5.96 light years away. With just 0.35% of the Sun's luminosity, its habitable zone is only 6% of Earth's distance from the Sun. Traditionally, we assume that any planet within this zone would be tidally locked, but newer models suggest it might still have a day-night cycle. Even if it doesn't, such a world could still be habitable. Orbital mirrors or shades positioned at L1 Lagrange points could provide artificial night on the day side and light to the dark side, and the planet's twilight band might also be useful for habitation. Beyond Barnard's Star, our other nearby options include Wolf 359, 7.9 light years away, best known for its disastrous battle against the Borg in Star Trek, as well as Lalande 21185, 8.3 light years, and Ross 158, 9.7 light years. All three are singular red dwarf systems. One major concern with red dwarfs is their frequent and intense solar flares. However, we might protect planets from these with solar-powered magnets at the L1 point, a concept already proposed for terraforming Mars. Such a system requires far less power than one might expect, but ultimately, civilizations capable of building arc ships for century-long voyages through space may not necessarily need or even want a planet at their destination. Since its inception, the National Space Society has promoted space settlement through habitats like the O'Neill Cylinder. Arc ships will likely incorporate smaller versions of these habitats, serving as living spaces for both people and the ecosystems they carry. Upon arrival, these self-sustaining environments would provide immediate shelter as terraforming an ideal planet, as terraforming even an ideal planet is a project spanning lifetimes. For many who make the journey, space habitats wouldn't just be a necessity, they might become the preferred way to live, especially compared to barren or inhospitable worlds. And given that most star systems likely contain asteroids, comets, and minor planets, we could construct thriving settlements without ever needing an Earth-like planet. These habitats could be powered by fusion or fission, but even simple mirror arrays could redirect and optimize light, making systems with red dwarfs or even white dwarfs like Sirius B, 8.6 light years away, viable locations for human habitation. With these possibilities in mind, the absence of nearby G-type stars is no barrier. Red dwarfs, white dwarfs, brown dwarfs, and even substellar objects could also support human expansion, so long as we bring our own light and energy with us. Expanding our search just a bit further, we find Epsilon Eridani, 10.7 light years, and Tau Ceti, 11.9 light years, two of the better known alternatives and long suggested as good prospects even before exoplanets were discovered around them. Both are yellow orange dwarfs, somewhat dimmer than our sun, but still prospects for future settlement. In total, there are around 60 star systems within 15 light years, hosting approximately 130 individual stars, including brown dwarfs. Altogether, we have plenty of options, but those closest to us would serve as valuable beachheads for human expansion, perhaps even the foundations of thriving interstellar civilizations, whether or not they contain habitable planets. If we want to travel the stars, we may need to evolve from a planet-bound civilization to a stellar one, and while Alpha Centauri remains our best nearby option, as we've seen today, many other promising prospects lie just beyond the horizon, waiting for those bold enough to journey to them.